You got to accentuate the positive, eliminate the negative, and latch on to the affirmative. Don't mess with Mr. In-Between.
Right, joining me for this third in our podcast, we have author Ben Aaronovitch, who is probably most famous for writing the Rivers of London series, but he's also written for Doctor Who, Jupiter Moon, Casualty, and Dark Knight. So, hello, Ben.
Hello, you can pan it the way you like it. I'm mostly famous for two things, Doctor Who and Rivers of London.
Fair enough.
Everything else is just padding.
So this series, which is a rather sort of slow-going, is called Accentuate the Positive, and I started doing it during COVID because I just thought we needed a bit of positivity. My question I tend to ask people first is, how are you?
I'm fine.
Good.
I'm a best-selling author. I'm living the life of work. I don't have to do anything that I consider to be work ever unless I want to.
So how did you find COVID?
Well, I liked the first 6 months. And then finally the lockdown began to get to me. But the first 6 months was great. I liked the first 6 months. Got loads of work done. It was brilliant.
I would take it from that that you're not particularly a social animal.
No, I am what they call it. I can't, there's a term for it. I'm an introvert capable of moments of extroversion.
Right.
When I'm in social situations, I tend to be quite extroverted, but I tend to avoid socials. I don't put it this way. I can't spend all day with people, but I've got to have at least 2-3 hours just to myself minimum, yeah. And preferably, you know, 8 or 9 hours to myself would be better.
No, I totally get that. So who forces these book tours on you then? Or are you sort of happy to?
Well, I mean, it's actually in my contract.
Right.
We'll do a reasonable amount of publicity work is actually in my contract. But also I like meeting people because otherwise I would not leave the house. And so therefore it's good for me to go out and meet people and talk to people. And this is good. I go out to places I wouldn't go to. I mean, would you go to Crewe unless you were sent there? No. And Crewe is a very interesting place.
No, never been to Crewe.
You stop at Crewe. You change trains at Crewe, but almost nobody ever gets out of the station and down to Crewe City Centre, which is what I did. And that was actually a very interesting experience. So
the only thing I can think of was about Crewe is there's a joke, isn't there, about crustacean and Crewe station. But that's it. That's all.
But yeah, so I like getting out. So that's fun. So, you know, and it's a good balance. It's not like they want me to write the book, so they can't send me out too much.
No. So as a writer, you're solitary. This is a solitary profession.
Yeah, solitary.
So COVID didn't affect it. What after 6 months made you finally realize this is a getting on? This is a bit too much.
I might like to see a couple of people.
Mm.
But, you know, also I wanted to do research and I couldn't travel.
Yeah. Yeah.
I like going out for lunch. Couldn't do that either. So that's where, I haven't gone out for lunch for ages. I hadn't discovered Deliveroo at that point, you see. So
right.
Yeah. I'm much better organized.
So we've moved out of COVID, thankfully. What do you think of things that there seem to be sort of a legacy of COVID in the sense of like there's a lot of Zoom meetings now. There never used to be Zoom meetings before COVID.
I don't mind doing Zoom interviews one-on-one. I don't mind doing Zoom meetings if it's about 3 or 4 people and it saves you having to meet somewhere. I don't like doing Zoom events. I don't mind doing hybrid events where some people are watching it on Zoom in front of an audience, but you need an audience. It's really hard to do an event without an audience, essentially. And I really didn't like The Unbelievable Truth when they didn't have an audience. They really needed an audience. It doesn't really work as a format without an audience. And so, therefore, I was quite glad when COVID ended for a variety of reasons.
Yes, they had.
I managed to catch it a couple of times, despite the fact that I didn't talk to it.
And you caught it? Oh God!
I had it. Yes, I had it.
How did it? How I? How was it? Was it?
It was. I had the 3-day lying in bed going version. And everything tasted funny. I didn't lose my sense of taste; just tasted funny.
Mm.
And then it was bad. I think it might have brought on my arthritis, but you never know. You can't tell with these things.
No.
So,
of course, now we and then you've got the COVID, and of course, I don't know about you. I sometimes think, I suppose I should look at the news, but I don't really want to look at the news because either stuff that just doesn't affect me, but it's horrible, or stuff that I think, oh, well, that might affect me. I don't want to think about that.
I mean, I'm very partisan. I'm politically partisan. So I enjoyed Trump losing the election, and the dethroning of Boris Johnson cheered me up no end. And you know, I was a bit kind of, oh God, but I've got to follow the news because my books are set about 4 years ago, and so therefore sooner or later I'm going to run into COVID and Boris and Brexit. So, but you know, I've been watching the Conservative Party eat itself has been cheered me up no end. So I was kind of much more depressed about the news until that happened.
Yeah, I mean, it's good that he's out. Of course, he's earning millions, isn't he, from after dinner speeches
I
and
don't
stuff.
care.
You don't care, right? As long as
No.
it's not.
I don't care. I'm not thinking about him now, except as a figure of fun and one of the world's most long Britain's least successful prime ministers in living memory, you see. So, you know, and then followed by whoever it was next, 44, the cabbage. The cabbage, right? You know.
I mean, I don't know about you. When she was voted in, I thought, I'll give her a chance. Give her a chance. Let's not be judgmental.
Well, like I said, I'm politically partisan, and so therefore I wasn't planning to give her a chance. I mean, it was just there's a section of the Conservative Party that's essentially a sort of mini-me GOP, right? They're mini-me American Republicans. There's a phrase that Tolkien uses about Saruman, and he says he turned the Orthanc into a slave's flattery of Barad-dûr. And I always think of that phrase, a slave's flattery, with these kind of like right-wing British Tories who think they're libertarian Republicans. But Britain is not America. Britain cannot just cut its taxes and grow its way out of something because it's not that kind of economy without tanking the currency and not that kind of currency. And it doesn't work in America either. Wisconsin was a total disaster, and so I'm not really that surprised. That, but they thought they could. They thought they could. They had that fire in their belly. They were libertarian monetarists. They were going to go out and they were going to do it. They were going to show it was possible. And what they showed was that it wasn't possible. And so then now you've got pragmatists like Sunak, but Sunak is just a pale imitation of Starmer, really. So in terms of pragmatism, so it's just, you know.
I suppose if we're being positive, if we're trying to be a bit positive, is there are there any politicians or people out there that you would respect, admire?
No, I respect Starmer because everyone wants him to shoot his mouth off and he's keeping his mouth shut. Right? There's no that you I keep reading these things. Oh, Starmer should come out and say this. Starmer, why the should he give the Daily Mail? At the moment, right, the Daily Mail is having way more fun, right? Tearing bits out of the Metropolitan Police and the Tory Party. Why would Starmer put himself up to be a target at this point? It's totally unnecessary. He's not going to get all the Labour votes he's currently going to get. He's not going to get any more of them by taking a strong rejoin the EU stance, for example, right? He's not going to get any more. So he keeps his powder dry. He keeps his powder dry. He wins the next election, and then he gets to actually implement some policies. Everyone wants him to shout their cause. Everyone, like whenever you read columnists in the paper, you can always paraphrase the column as something like, this thing that's happening now proves I was right about this other thing that I've been talking about for the last year. Right? So,
So
you know, it's
you're
part of
happy
that.
for you're happy for the Tories just to sail grace not gracefully, that just to sail into defeat and then we'll get something a bit better next year or the year after.
Well, you know, it's I want them to be utterly humiliated in the election. You know, I still remember 97. I still have fond memories of 97.
Yeah,
Right?
that's
So
Eurovision. We won Eurovision and we had Tony Blair. That was
but
pretty.
do you remember people like Michael Portello lost their seats? I
Who
voted in
Stephen
that
Quigg,
seat.
wasn't
Yeah,
it?
I voted. Yeah, I voted in that seat.
Oh, brilliant.
Actually voted in that seat. So I, you know, and they had a graphic. It was one of those early computer graphics. They had a graphic of a landslide burying prominent Tories, which is, you know, I liked it so much. I borrowed the tapes from my work and watched both sides. I watched it on ITV. I'd watched it all night on BBC, and then I watched it all night on ITV.
I always think that I mean, one of the saddest facts of politics is it's a snake eating itself, and the worse it gets, the fewer people vote. And I can understand, but I don't agree. Everyone should vote, I think.
I think we should have an Australian system.
No, totally, I agree. And I've been to Australia twice, and the two times I've been, when they've had their votes, and I love the way they just go, oh, I'm just going to get to go and vote. Or we do it after tea, and it's completely, that's what they do, they vote.
Well, if you make voting compulsory, yeah, right, you have to make it really easy. You can't make it compulsory and difficult. So if you have compulsory voting, you have to make it really easy.
Yeah, I mean, compulsory voting, you get fined if you don't vote. You can go and you can scrap
the paper. I don't see it as a civil liberties issue at all.
No, I mean, we have to do the census, we're fine. So I don't see any difference about this. And I think it's a shame that the conversation seems to have completely stopped about that.
Well, you only have to look at what Russell Brand has become now to see that all that guff about not voting 5 years ago was just basically a setup for the Tories, which is what I thought at the time. But people fall in love with these characters. They think, oh, he's so different. No. Politics is about pragmatism. Right? Idealism is handy. You always want idealists to go out there and be idealistic and chain themselves to trains and stuff. But politics, actual practical politics, actually making the world a better place, is done one boring white paper at a time.
Yeah. Well, it's like wars always end in peace talks, don't they? Let's just go straight to
that. No, World War II ended in absolute unconditional surrender by both aggressive
powers. Yeah.
Right, and Italy just rolled over, which I suppose they don't count.
So you don't sound like, well, I don't know, does the news or anything like that make you angry? Or are you fairly laissez-faire? And you think, well,
I think a bit, neither did the Vietnam War. Well, with the North of Vietnam just rolled over South Vietnam.
Okay, I'm wrong.
It's like one of those things like the victors always write the history books. Bollocks to that. When was the last time you watched a film, right, where the English were the good guys in the struggle with Scotland? Yeah, so I rest my case. About the victors writing the history books.
What do you watch, or what films do you enjoy as a means of recreation?
I watch all the Marvels.
All the what?
The Marvels. I watch.
Oh, okay, fine.
I've got very shallow tastes. I've watched a lot of Korean drama comedies recently because they seem to be doing weird comedy things, and so I kind of like that. And because Netflix immediately starts recommending suddenly you watch one Korean thing and suddenly they're recommending everything.
Yeah.
I watch anything with a spaceship in it, really. Anything spaceship. I don't watch serious dramas. Life is too depressing to watch serious dramas. I read a lot of cozy crime while I'm working because it doesn't distract from my writing. It's very difficult. If you read something that's like really good in a different genre while you're writing, you tend to want to write that immediately, and you're supposed to be writing the book you're writing. So I read a lot of cozy crime because, not that it's easy, but because it's just fun. And I just like reading it, but it doesn't make, I don't immediately want to go off and write a cozy crime novel. Although I have, come up with a couple of ideas while reading them. So,
have you read Richard Osman's books?
Yeah, well, I've blurbed Richard Osman. Read it? I blurbed it.
You blurbed it, so you must think that you must enjoy them.
Yeah, I like cozy crime. I liked his one because it's like the kind of the details of being a country clergy was quite obviously something he knew quite a lot about. Mm. So therefore, that was kind of fun. So.
I guess this country seems to have a good tradition of cosy crime in the sense that it gets you out into the country, into country vicarages, but also you might get some blood and knives and guns and stuff.
I mean, cosy crime, you can have cosy crime anywhere. There's like very good cosy crime. Like Simon Brett does cosy crime with his series about Charles Paris. That's cosy crime. That's frequently in cities. The idea that it's all vicarages and tea cakes I think, a mistake, really. It's one of those things that it's like when they think, oh, Agatha Christie wrote about vicarages and tea cakes. Agatha Christie was as subversive as all the time, right? All her work is incredibly subversive. And, you know, and she delighted in just taking conventions and turning them on their head and turning them inside out. You know, so it's, I don't necessarily like, the countryside's fine, but I get a nosebleed when the population falls below 7,000 per square kilometer. So, you know, it's not good for you, all that fresh air.
Do you are you into the Star Wars and all the spin-offs and Disney and stuff like that?
Yeah, well, I had a child. I mean, I have a son. He's grown up now, but I kind of like got so watched so many of those films all the way through, whether I wanted to or not. Like, I must have seen Elf about 15 times,
right?
And to the point where my, you know, I can't face the bloody guy. It's not his fault. I just cannot face that. So just the look on his face makes me want to hit him. So,
Elf, so do you enjoy Christmas? Is Christmas something you look forward to or something?
No, I like Christmas. I don't see my family very much, so it's nice to see my family. It doesn't go on for too long. We don't do that thing where you stay overnight for 5 days or something. You turn up, you eat a huge meal, you hand over presents, you stagger into the taxi and go home. That's basically Christmas.
Yeah. Do you like things like birthdays and whatnot? Do you like attention?
Not like my birthday, no.
No.
No. No. I try and not be around for my birthday so that people can't do things.
Why is that?
59.
Is it a recent thing, or were you happy with birthdays when you were younger?
I quite like birthdays up until about the mid-30s, and then after that, I just kind of went off them.
It does feel a bit like you're marking down rather than up, doesn't it?
I think I might have a big bash of the 60. I don't know. I just don't like parties very much, to be honest. I don't like social events. I don't like being the centre of a social event, because then you can't slope off. So, you know, if you could slope off at your own birthday party, I'd be fine with it. But I'm just not a very birthday person. I like presents. Don't want people to not give me presents. I like presents. But I don't like parties. I never really have. One of my big regrets, one of the things I said to my son when he was younger, when he was like 13 or 14, I said, listen to me, this is very important. Okay, I spend a lot of time going to clubs and parties where I spectacularly failed to get off with anyone ever, right? And getting drunk and being just bored out of my shitless out of my mind half the time. And when I wasn't drunk and bored, I said, what I should have done is played more Dungeons and Dragons, right? I would have been much happier, and I don't think it would have made any difference to my socialization whatsoever. So don't let anyone convince you that going out and playing Dungeons and Dragons or something like that is not worthwhile.
Brilliant. Okay. So the message to people listening or watching would be, don't conform to what other people tell you to do.
No, don't think that people who go out to clubs and if you don't enjoy going to clubs, don't go to clubs. Just because some other people look like they're enjoying themselves.
Well, that applies to everything, I guess, doesn't it?
I can say that with authority.
Right.
I can speak from absolute personal authority. I mean, it's probably more generally applicable, but on that particular thing, don't go to clubs, play Dungeons and Dragons. Or, you know, doesn't have to be Dungeons and Dragons. It could be Traveller.
You know. And to those people who are watching, who are trying to write and get published, well, what sort of advice would you give them?
Okay, I've honed this down to three items. Well, four items. Well, possibly five items. But one, buy a decent chair. Very important. Okay? Buy a decent chair, because if you are going to become a professional writer, you're going to spend an awful lot of time in that chair. And by the time you're 40, you're really going to know if you didn't sit in a proper chair, right? So get a proper chair right away. Don't freaking wait for your back to go, okay? Two, write the book you want to write, okay? People will talk to you about market research, bollocks, right? You'll never hit the zeitgeist. The zeitgeist will have moved by the time you get there, okay? So write the book you want to write. But if you want it to be published, you're going to have to write it to a certain standard and conform to certain things. The best book for that is How Not to Write a Novel, by Howard Mittelmark, right? And that's a funny book, and it will tell you all the things that publishers will throw your book across the room if they find in it. And it's very useful, but also, this is going to sound like a bit of a contradiction, you can break the rules, right? Okay, and then there's what I call the Shakespeare rule, is you can steal from anybody providing you make it better, right? So you can steal from any author you like, providing what you write is better than what they write. And then I have what I call the Aaronovitch corollary to the Shakespeare rule, right? Which is read a lot of trash. There's no piece of television or book or fiction that's so bad that doesn't contain at least one good idea that you can nick. And of course, if it's from a terrible book that nobody remembers, no one will notice that you've done it. Yay!
Best terrible book you can recommend off the top of your head?
No, I think you should all read. You should, but don't just read terrible books. Yeah, okay. That would be fine. No, because you're bombarded with crap. You don't need to go looking for crap. Crap will find you. If you turn on the television for 5 minutes, bad television will find you. Stuff will find you. You're walking. You get trapped in the cinema and you go, oh my God, this is terrible. How did this get made? But when you're doing that, look for the one really good idea. The thing will be is like, yeah, that would have been a really good idea if they'd done this with that, right? That's an idea you can steal. Okay. Right. That's an idea. That's basically someone handing you a plate full of delicious food. Well, thank you very much. You can take that away and you can use that idea and you can use it the way you thought it should be used. And they can't complain about it because they should have done it the way you did it. So, also almost nobody ever gets sued over that sort of thing in this country anyway.
Mm-hmm. That's brilliant. Thank you very much for talking to me, Ben. Lovely. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Pandemonium liable to walk upon the scene. You got to ask.